Recorded Books and One Click Digital present The Patriarch, a Bruno Chief of Police novel by Martin Walker. Narrated by Robert Ian Mackenzie. Chapter 1. Benoit Courrèges, Chief of Police of the small French town of Saint-Denis, and known to everyone as Bruno, had been looking forward to this day so much that he'd never considered the possibility that it might end in tragedy. The prospect of meeting his boyhood hero, of being invited into his home and shaking the hand of one of France's most illustrious sons, had awed him, and Bruno was not easily awed. Bruno had followed the career of the Patriarch since, as a boy, he had first read of his exploits in a much-thumbed copy of Parry Match in a dentist's waiting room. He had devoured the article and dreamed of starting a scrapbook on his newfound hero, but had no money for the magazines and newspapers he would require. The young Bruno made do instead with libraries, first at his church orphanage, and later, when he'd been taken into the stormy, child-filled household of his aunt, at the public library in Bergerac. The images had remained in his head, his hero silhouetted against camouflaged fighter planes in the snow, wearing shorts and a heavy sidearm in some desert, drinking toasts in one ornate palace or grand salon after another. His favourite was the one that showed the Patriarch as pilot, his helmet just removed and his hair tousled, waving from his cockpit to a cheering crowd of mechanics and airmen after he'd become the first Frenchman to break the sound barrier. Bruno couldn't help but smile at his own excitement. His boyhood was long behind him, and he knew grown men should not feel like this. Bruno had worn a military uniform himself, knew the chaos of orders and counterorders and all the messy friction of war. He knew, as only a veteran can, that the public image of the Patriarch must conceal flaws, fiascos, and botched operations. He should have grown out of this hero worship, or at least appeased it now that he had been able to call up old newsreels and TV interviews on his computer. But some stubborn, glowing core remained of that boyhood devotion he'd felt for a man he thought of as France's last hero. As he waited in the receiving line to shake his hero's hand, Bruno knew that he'd never attended an event so lavish nor so exclusive. The chateau was not large, just three floors and four sets of windows on each side of the imposing double doors of the entrance, but its proportions were perfect, and it had been lovingly restored. While the adjoining tower with its stubby battlements was medieval, the chateau embodied the discreet elegance of the 18th century. The string quartet on the balcony overlooking the formal garden was playing the fall movement from Vivaldi's Four Seasons, a piece that perfectly suited the surroundings. Bruno could imagine the Fragonard paintings of perfectly posed maidens that should grace its rooms. He knew they had been painted at around the same time as some pre-revolution nobleman had transformed his ancestors' fortress into a comfortable home. Below the balcony, at least 100 people were sipping champagne as they chatted and strolled in the garden. The sound of women's laughter made a perfect backdrop to the music. On the broad terrace to which Bruno was restricted by the wheelchair he steered, at least as many guests again were mingling, taking glasses from the trays offered by the waiters dressed in Air Force uniforms. He heard snatches of conversation in English, German, Russian, and Arabic, and picked out at least a dozen different national uniforms. He recognized politicians from Paris, Toulouse, and Bordeaux, mostly conservatives, but with a scattering of socialist mayors and ministers from the government in Paris. Whenever Bruno spotted them gathering in their usual partisan clumps, they always seemed to defer to a stunningly attractive blonde woman whom Bruno had just met, the Patriarch's daughter-in-law, Madeleine, who was acting as hostess. She had given Bruno only a cool smile of welcome while shaking his hand perfunctorily in a way that moved him on to her husband next in the receiving line. Beyond the formal garden of the chateau, the fields to the right sloped gently away to the Dordogne River, and the grazing Charolais cattle upon them looking as if they had been carefully posed in place. to the left, between two ridges that were covered in trees turning golden red, one of the lazy curves of the Weser River glinted in the autumnal sun. Even the weather, Bruno thought, wouldn't dare to spoil the 90th birthday of such a distinguished son of France.
"This must be one of the finest views in the country," the Red Countess said from her wheelchair. "Our own view is pretty good, but that church spire on one side of the river and the ruined castle on the other give this one something that is almost perfection. Marco bought it for a song, you know. I was with him when he first saw this place and decided to buy it. I think it helped that my own chateau was close by." She paused, smiling. "Marco was one of my happier affairs. It lasted longer than most."
"Where did you meet him?" asked Marie-Françoise, the Countess's American-born heiress.
Just out of her teens, she was looking fresh and enchanting in a simple dress of heavy blue silk that matched her eyes. Her French, once halting but improved by private coaching and by her time at the University of Bordeaux, was now fluent.
"I met him in Moscow, where he was a star. It was the Kremlin reception after Stalin's funeral, and Marco looked magnificent in full dress uniform. Everybody knew him, of course. Our ambassador was put out that Marco was given precedence over him. Khrushchev came up to embrace him. Apparently they'd met somewhere on the Ukrainian front after the Battle of Stalingrad."
She looked up at her great-granddaughter and gave a gleeful smile that made her look younger than her years.
"I'll never forget those frosty glances from the other women present when Marco came up to give me his arm. Mon Dieu, he was a handsome beast. He still is, in his way."
Bruno followed her gaze to the double doors leading into the chateau, where the man known across France as the Patriarch was still receiving his guests. He stood erect in his beautifully cut suit of navy blue, the red of his tie matching the discreet silk in his lapel that marked him as one of the Légion d'honneur. His back was as straight as a ruler, and his thick white hair fell in curls onto his collar. His jaw was still as firm as his handshake, and his sharp brown eyes missed nothing. They'd looked curiously at Bruno as he'd first appeared pushing the wheelchair. But once Bruno was introduced by the Red Countess as the local policeman who had saved her life, the Patriarch's eyes had crinkled into warm appreciation.
"That is the magic of this woman," the old man had said in the voice of a much younger man, and he bent to kiss her hand. "She always finds a knight-errant when she needs one."
Colonel Jean-Marc Dessay, the Patriarch, had been honored as a war hero in two countries with the Grand Cross of the Légion d'honneur and the Gold Star and Red Ribbon of a Hero of the Soviet Union. The first had been presented by his friend, Charles de Gaulle, and the second by Stalin himself at a glittering ceremony in the Kremlin. Like most French boys, Bruno knew that the Normandie-Niemann squadron of French pilots flying Soviet-built Yak fighters had shot down more enemy aircraft than any other French unit. It had been the second-highest-scoring squadron in all the Russian Air Force, shooting down 273 enemy planes. 22 of these had been downed by Marco, then a dashing and handsome young man whose bold good looks were featured constantly in the Soviet newsreels and newspapers. As people heard of his exploits over the BBC, Marco became a hero at a time when France had sore need of such warriors. Marco had qualified as a fighter pilot in the first days of May 1940, just as the 2nd French Cavalry Division was trotting through the wooded trails of the Ardennes to repel what they thought was a German reconnaissance force. What they encountered was the 7th Panzer Division, led by General Erwin Rommel, whose tanks brushed the French cavalry aside and launched an assault that would take them to the English Channel in less than 2 weeks. Marco saw no action in France. The day after getting his wings, he was posted to the French colony of Syria, flying one of the underpowered Morane Saunier fighters that had proved so inferior to the German Messerschmitts in the Battle for France. In 1941, when the British invaded and occupied Syria to prevent the Luftwaffe from using its air bases, Marco was one of more than 5,000 French servicemen who volunteered to join de Gaulle. It was while Marco was retraining on British Spitfires that de Gaulle persuaded Stalin to accept a squadron of French pilots to serve on the Eastern Front, where the German panzers were closing in on the Volga River and on Stalingrad. Marco traded in his desert shorts for winter clothing and joined the squadron of French volunteers on the long train journey north through Persia and the Caucasus. As the defenders of Stalingrad held out, Marco and his colleagues were retraining on Yakovlev fighters. And just after the besieged and frozen remnants of the German army under Field Marshal Paulus surrendered, the Normandy squadron was declared operational. Bruno had read it all. As a boy, he'd thrilled to the exotic Syria, tried to imagine the long train journey from desert heat to Russian cold, and to the present day he remembered that the French fighters shot down their first enemy, a Focke-Wulf fighter, on the 5th of April 1943. By the end of the summer, they'd shot down 70 more, and only 6 of the pilots were still alive. But they had won more than just their dogfights. The Nazi Field Marshal, Wilhelm Keitel, had ordered that any captured French pilot should be shot out of hand, rebels and traitors to their Vichy-run homeland, and their families in France should be arrested and dispatched to concentration camps. Bruno had vowed to become a pilot, just like his hero, until an overworked teacher in his overcrowded school told him brusquely that his poor scores in math and physics ruled out any prospect of being accepted by the French Air Force. As the next best thing, before his 17th birthday, Bruno volunteered to join the French army. Marco Desailly had returned to France in 1945, leading the flight of 40 Yak fighters that Stalin had decided the Normandie-Niemen pilots could fly home to join the reborn French Air Force. Then, in 1948, with discreet official backing, Marco volunteered to fly for the infant state of Israel. He found himself flying a Messerschmitt fighter donated by the Czech government and became an ace all over again. Back in France afterward, he joined Dassault Aviation as a test pilot and became the first French pilot to break the sound barrier. Marco then helped Dassault sell its Mystère and Mirage jet fighters to become the core of the new Israeli Air Force and launched his next career as a businessman, becoming a director of Dassault and later of Air France and Airbus. Finally, in tribute to a long and patriotic career, he had been elected to the Senate. It was an epic life that Bruno knew by heart. Bruno felt he would be attending the party of the year in Périgord. He suspected he'd not been invited on his own account, but as the escort to the Red Countess, as a man who could be relied on to manage a wheelchair and its fragile passenger. Chapter 2. Among the guests in the garden, Bruno saw only a handful of people he knew. The mayor and Dr. Gelitro from Saint-Denis were chatting with Hubert, who owned the town's celebrated wine cave. As he spotted them, the men were joined by the stylish Clotilde Daunier, curator of the National Museum of Prehistory at Les Aisies, and a scholar with an international reputation. Beyond them, he saw his friend Jack Crimson, a supposedly retired British spymaster who had a house outside Saint-Denis, chatting amicably with the French foreign minister. Beside Crimson, Bruno saw Pamela, who had been his lover for the past year, although he wondered increasingly how long their affair would continue. She'd been delighted when Crimson had asked her to accompany him to the Patriarch's birthday, but had courteously asked Bruno if he approved. Of course, he had said, stilling the twinge of jealousy that lasted until the Red Countess had called to ask him to escort her and her great-granddaughter. Pamela, looking very fine with her red bronze hair piled high, caught his eye. Feeling obliged to stay in attendance on the Countess, Bruno waved, beckoning her to join them on the terrace. Pamela raised her glass to him with a cool smile, but then left him feeling deflated as she turned back to her conversation. Then the Red Countess waved at a young woman in the crowd. She evidently knew the Patriarch's family well. His son, Victor, also a former pilot who now ran the family vineyard, and Victor's very attractive wife, Madeleine, had each embraced her in the receiving line. Victor was around 60, Bruno calculated, but his vivacious wife seemed very much younger. Bruno would have guessed her to be in her early 30s, so he was startled when their daughter, Chantal, approached and eagerly hugged Marie-Françoise, whom she knew from the university. Chantal must be at least 20, he thought, so that made her mother around 40, Bruno's own age. As Chantal greeted the Countess enthusiastically and Bruno politely, her mother suddenly appeared. She put one hand on her daughter's shoulder and the other on Marie-Françoise and posed, briefly cocking an eyebrow at Bruno before saying to the Countess,
"Marie-Françoise looks so like those famous photos of you when you were her age. You must be so proud of her."
"At my age, it's privilege enough just to see your great-grandchild, let alone to watch her beauty grow," the Countess replied. "And Marco tells me he can hardly wait for Marc or Chantal to make him a great-grandpapa."
"Don't listen to her, chérie," Madeleine said to her daughter with a laugh that didn't sound quite as carefree as she'd intended. "I'm in no hurry for you to make me a grandmother."
She gave Bruno an appraising glance.
"So, this is the local policeman who saved you from your awful sister."
"He saved me, too, in the cave," said Marie-Françoise. "I'll never forget it. The gunfire in that enclosed place, and then Bruno undressing me after I'd been pulled out from that underground lake." She gave him a cheeky smile. "I feared the worst, Bruno, until you rubbed me down and dressed me in dry clothes from that plump policeman."
Bruno remembered the stricken look of the girl, her face bloody and her mouth caved in from where she'd been hit with a gun butt. There was no sign of her injuries now, and her teeth looked as perfect as expensive dentistry could make them. "You were very brave, and you look lovely now," Bruno said. He gestured at the three blonde women standing before him. "All three of you look wonderful, the three graces of the Périgord."
"Beware of dangerous flatterers like this, you two," said Madeleine, rolling her eyes and laughing as she hugged the two girls. "Gunplay and gallant compliments make for a heady combination. Both of you must come to lunch at the vineyard and tell us all about that time in the cave. I never really heard the whole story," said Chantal. "Good idea. Maybe when Grandpa comes. I know he'd like to hear it too," said Madeleine. "And you must come too, Hortense," she said to the Countess. "You know how Grandpa loves to see you. I'll call to confirm the date."
"I'd be delighted, and you can rely on me to bring the Countess," said Bruno. "You can always reach me at the Saint-Denis Mairie." Bruno felt Madeleine's eyes stay on him as her daughter asked the Countess if she might take Marie-Françoise away to join some of the younger guests in the garden. He watched as the three women left. From the rear, they looked identical, slim-hipped, long-legged, and elegant, each moving with the same assured grace.
"There are some other members of Marco's family you should meet," said the Red Countess, "but they're all well brought up, even the foreign ones. They'll see us stuck here in the balcony, and they'll come to greet me. Madeleine was very well brought up, so she'll see to it, despite the way she's using this party to advance her political career. There's a very pleasant woman whom you ought to meet, Raquel, the daughter from Marco's Israeli wife," she went on when Bruno inquired about the non-French family members. "Marco had just divorced her when we met. Raquel has lived here in the Périgord for 40 years. She's always been a favourite of mine, one of the artists who did the reconstruction of the Lascaux cave. Then there's Yevgeny, his son by a Russian woman in wartime. I first met Yevgeny in Moscow when he was a little boy, and here he is."
A big-boned bear of a man in his 60s with grey hair tumbling to his shoulders had suddenly appeared before the wheelchair and knelt to take the Red Countess into his arms. He kissed her soundly and sat back on his heels to admire her.
"They told me you were bedridden," he said in strongly accented French.
"Much exaggerated, and it was all the fault of my dreadful sister and her crooked grandson, César," she said. "You can thank the young man standing behind me for rescuing me."
She gestured at Bruno, and Yevgeny shook his hand.
"You were what, 7 or 8 when I first laid eyes on you?" she asked Yevgeny.
8, and I'd never seen anything in Moscow like you, all dressed in Dior and with your long cigarette holder. You were like something from films," Yevgeny said, smiling. "And then you took me to your film premiere and gave me French chocolates. You know I've been in love with you ever since."
"From what I hear, Yevgeny, you say that to a lot of women. Is it true you're living here now?"
"Yes, I have a house near Siorac, with glorious light and a big barn that serves as my gallery. You have to come and see my latest paintings."
He turned to Bruno and said,
"I did a whole series of portraits of the Countess, all called Parisienka, the woman from Paris. The first ones were from my boyhood memory, but then she started coming to Moscow again, and I could paint her from life."
"It's all a long time ago," the Countess said.
Bruno was doing the math in his head. If Yevgeny had been 8 when Stalin died, he had been born in 1944 or 1945, and therefore conceived as a war baby. Marco had divorced his Israeli wife by the time he met the Countess in 1953, so Yevgeny's half-sister, Raquel, would be just a few years younger. And then there was Marco's third child, Victor, the one who ran the vineyard. 3 children by different mothers, and all 3 gathered here for their father's birthday, and all living nearby. It said a lot for the old man that he remained that close to his children, and even more that they wanted to be near him. Or maybe the attraction lay in the eventual inheritance, Bruno thought, looking around at the chateau with its well-kept grounds. The patriarch was usually described as a wealthy businessman, and he must have made money from his directorships. The family vineyard in the hills above La Lande was respected, mostly producing Bergerac reds and whites with a small and separate vineyard in Montbazillac, but it was hardly a gold mine. Bruno knew the old saying that the way to make a small fortune in wine was to start with a large one. "I understand why one might have preferred to leave Russia in the former times of the Soviet Union," Bruno said, "but has not life improved in Russia these days?"
"In some ways it's better, like cars and money and foreign travel," Yevgeny replied. "Many other things stay the same, like the weather. But for an artist or a writer, the big difference is that we have lost our great patron, the state. In Soviet times, a member of the Writers' or Artists' Union was guaranteed a stipend, commissions, a studio, even a dacha in the country. It was a strange system, but agreeable enough if one was part of it and didn't bother much about politics. These days, we are thrown back on our own resources, or rather on the dubious tastes of our rich oligarchs and their flighty mistresses."
"And naturally, they prefer to buy what's fashionable rather than your best work," said the Countess.
"I thought your father was very much in favor with the current government," Bruno said. As they had waited in the receiving line, there had been time to study the array of photos that lined the hallway, the patriarch meeting various dignitaries. He was posed with 6 presidents of France, 2 American presidents, with Stalin and Khrushchev, Brezhnev and Gorbachev, Yeltsin, Putin, and Deng Xiaoping. Alongside these were photos of him with popes, German chancellors, British prime ministers, assorted generals, astronauts, film stars, and opera singers. The Red Countess had preened at a photo of her younger self with the Patriarch at a Cannes film festival in the 50s. A young Brigitte Bardot was in the photo too, but the Patriarch had eyes only for the Red Countess.
Putin is a very old-fashioned kind of Russian who remembers the war and its heroes, even though he wasn't even born at the time, Yevgeny said. Still, my father's fame and his medals have their limits. He was invited to the Kremlin, yet he couldn't get me a Soviet exit visa. He had great blood, but only in certain fields.
Blood? Bruno asked, baffled by the word.
It means influence or pull, the ability to command favors. You French have the word piston, which means much the same thing.
As he spoke, there was the sound of a glass breaking, and a small altercation seemed to be taking place just below their place on the balcony, with raised voices and suddenly a swirl of people. An older man who looked drunk was pulling Chantal by the arm, and she was resisting and telling him to let go, helped by Marie-Françoise. Victor, the Patriarch's younger son, suddenly appeared through the crowd, Dr. Gelitro at his side. The Saint-Denis parish priest, Father Santou, seemed to come from nowhere with a good-looking young man who bore more than a passing resemblance to the Patriarch. Before Bruno could push his way to the steps to join the rescue party, they managed between them to separate the drunken man from Chantal. They were joined by a new figure, a large, burly man dressed in a tweed jacket and flat cap and wearing boots and gaiters that gave him the look of an old-fashioned gamekeeper. He put his arms around the drunk, lifted him bodily, and then carried him away. The other men followed, except for the young man who remained with Chantal. She sank gratefully into his arms, but seemed none the worse for the incident. The buzz of conversation had silenced for a moment as people turned and craned their necks to see the cause of the flurry. But the string quartet continued to saw away at their instruments, and the babble of voices quickly renewed. Who were those men? Bruno asked the Countess, noting with approval the brisk efficiency with which the disturbance had been managed.
I don't know the big one. He looked like some kind of servant, she replied. The handsome youth is Mark, Victor's son, Marco's grandson. He's here to learn the family business before going to business school in America. Marco thinks his grandson will make a fine match for Marie-Françoise. I agree, so we're arranging for them to see a fair amount of one another. It would be a very good marriage for both families.
Bruno was surprised, assuming that the days of arranged marriages were long over. But when it came to countesses and chateaux, perhaps the old ways continued as they always had. The Patriarch's money and the Countess's estates and titles would make quite a combination. "Were you ever tempted to marry the Patriarch yourself?" he asked her. She looked up at him, amused.
"There are men you marry for the family's sake and men you take to bed for your own. I'm not sure it makes sense to confuse the two."
"And who was the drunk pulling at Chantal?" he asked.
"Gilbert, an old friend of the family," she said.
Gilbert had befriended Victor when they were cadets together at the French Air Force Academy at Salon de Provence, and they went on to serve in the same squadron as fighter pilots. When Victor left to join Air France, Gilbert remained in uniform and became an air attaché at the French embassy in Moscow, where there had been some kind of scandal. The Countess didn't know the details. Charming but always a heavy drinker, Gilbert was now a barely functioning alcoholic with a trail of affairs and failed marriages behind him. Thanks to Victor, he lived in a small house on the family estate and had the nominal job of cataloguing the Patriarch's archives. Bruno left to get a plate of canapé from the buffet for the Red Countess, whose wheelchair had a neat folding table attached from which she could eat. When he returned, balancing two glasses of champagne and two plates, she was in conversation with an elegantly dressed white-haired woman in her 60s who had one bold lock of coal-black hair running back from her forehead.
"Meet Raquel, the Patriarch's daughter," the Countess said. I've told her all about you, and she can have my glass of champagne. I'll go on to the white wine.
Bruno shook hands and told Raquel he admired the copy of the Lascaux cave she had worked on and asked about her new venture.
It's at Le Tote, the prehistory park with the antique animals, Raquel replied in a deep, attractive voice. We're upgrading it now with virtual reality and animatronics, lifelike mammoths and aurochs that we designed on computers. It's fun learning new skills at my age. Some of the family are coming to lunch next week to see our progress so far. Would you like to come along?
She handed him a business card with the image of some wild-looking men in furs brandishing spears and stones as they surrounded a trapped mammoth. Her phone number and email address were on the reverse side. Suddenly there came the insistent sound of a spoon being tapped on a glass. The string quartet had stopped playing, and the patriarch had advanced to the edge of the balcony, his arms held up for silence.
Excellencies, generals, friends, you know I never give speeches, far less long ones, he said, pausing for the laughter. So I simply thank you all for coming here to my native Périgord to celebrate my 90th birthday, and I hope you will all return in 10 years' time for the big one. I'll be here if you will.
There was more laughter and scattered cheers.
And now, if today's Armée de l'Air is half as punctual as we were in my day, you might want to protect your ears.
He gazed to the west and pointed. Bruno became aware of a distant growl growing steadily louder, saw the sun glinting on distant wings, and then with a monstrous howl that seemed to shake every bone in Bruno's body, three rafales swept overhead, unbelievably low and impossibly fast. France's latest jet fighters, worth €100 million each and capable of twice the speed of sound, the Rafales lit their afterburners and soared into a vertical climb. Plumes of red, white and blue smoke spilled from their tails in salute. Then the aircraft rose in formation and spread apart. Somewhere over Salah, they turned and came diving back in line astern, each warplane performing a victory roll as it passed over the patriarch's head.
Mon dieu, I loved that,
said the patriarch as the roar of the jets faded into the distance.
My thanks to my friends, the Minister of Defense, and to General Dufour for that wonderful demonstration, and to the memory of my revered old boss, Marcel Dussault, who has given France so many magnificent airplanes. I only wish I were still flying them. And my thanks to all of you who are French taxpayers who paid for that splendid birthday gift. And now, enjoy the rest of the party.
The Red Countess was wilting. Chantal said she'd bring Marie-Françoise home later. The old lady made her farewells, and Bruno wheeled her back through the house, out to her car, and drove her home. It had been a remarkable day, he reflected. His boyhood admiration had not been in the least dented by the reality of meeting the patriarch. And he was invited to one lunch by Raquel, and to another at the vineyard, where he'd be able to see more of the great man and maybe hear some of his stories. He saw the Countess installed safely back in her chateau and drove contentedly home to walk his dog, feed his chickens, and tend his vegetable garden, and knew nothing of the tragedy that was unfolding in the house that had just echoed to the roar of the Rafales. It was only the following morning when the mayor called to tell Bruno of the death that had taken place. Chapter 3. Just after dawn the next morning, Bruno had begun sharing his breakfast with his basset hound, Balzac, when the mayor phoned. He sounded subdued and shaken as he said he was calling from the patriarch's chateau where there had been a death. Startled, Bruno paused before voicing his immediate concern for the patriarch himself, but the mayor rang off before Bruno could ask for any details. That was odd, Bruno thought, as he changed into his police uniform and headed off in his official van. He was usually informed of deaths by the emergency services, or by a doctor, or by a priest. As a municipal policeman, Bruno was an employee of the town of Saint-Denis, which meant that the mayor was his boss. This was the first time he'd been summoned to a death scene by the man who'd hired him, and Bruno wondered what the mayor was doing at the Patriarch's place so early. The chateau felt different in the early morning light, somber rather than joyous, without the animation brought by the previous day's throng of fashionably dressed people. Bruno parked, and seeing no signs of life at the front of the building, he walked around the terrace, calling to ask if anyone was there. Just as he was beginning to wonder if his summons were some bizarre joke, the mayor came out to greet him with a handshake.
"You'll just have to take care of a few formalities," he said, steering Bruno indoors. "Dr. Gelatro has already signed the death certificate."
The dead man was in a large semicircular room in the base of the old medieval tower that seemed to be used mainly to store garden furniture and tools. The body rested on a lounger of tubular steel and canvas that would have looked more at home beside a swimming pool. The room stank of booze and vomit and was full of people when Bruno arrived, although it was almost too dark to see. A single narrow window slit and the open door that led to the chateau provided the only light. As his eyes grew accustomed to the gloom, Bruno made out Victor and Madeleine standing hand in hand beside the lounger. Victor had his other hand over his eyes, and his shoulders moved as if he were weeping. His wife held a handkerchief to her nose. Dr. Gelatro was packing his stethoscope into an ancient medical case. Father Santou was also there, and Bruno spotted the gleam of oil on the eyes and forehead that meant the dead man had been given the last rites.
"Accidental death," said the doctor. "Died in the night, dead drunk, no suspicious circumstances."
He sidled up to Bruno and murmured in his ear,
"The poor fellow drowned in his own vomit."
That was quick, Bruno thought. Gelatro usually hemmed and hawed and left his options open. "Who found him?"
"I did, this morning, expecting to find Gilbert nursing his usual hangover, so I brought him some breakfast," said Victor, turning to Bruno and releasing his wife's hand.
He looked stricken as he pointed to a tray on a small side table. It carried a coffee pot, a cup, and a glass of orange juice.
"I shook him to wake him up, but he was already pretty stiff, so I called our family doctor. Dr. Gelatro came right away.
The night wasn't cold, so I'd put the time of death at around midnight, maybe a bit before or after," the doctor said. "I checked the lividity and the body temperature. He died here and hasn't been moved."
Bruno stepped forward to stand beside the lounger and looked down on the face of the drunk who had tried to pull Chantal away at the party. Somebody had cleaned his face and chin, but there were drying pools of vomit on his chest and on the lounger where it had trailed down the side of his neck. The dead man, Gilbert, had been an old Air Force friend of Victor. After becoming too old to fly fast jets, he'd been air attaché in Moscow. "My condolences on the loss of an old friend," Bruno said, facing Victor. "I'm sorry, but you'll understand I have to ask a few questions, just for the formal report. I saw you escort him away from the party yesterday afternoon, just before the flyby for your father. Is this room where you brought him?"
"Yes, it was convenient and close by, a place we could put him down to sleep it off," Victor replied. "Gilbert was plastered, staggering drunk. We just wanted him out of the way quickly. I knew the flyby would be coming, and I didn't want that spoiled for my father's sake. He'd been looking forward to it for weeks."
"I saw Gilbert carried off by someone who didn't look dressed for the party," Bruno said. "Who would that have been?"
"That was Fabrice, the gamekeeper," said Madeleine. "When I saw what was happening, I asked him to remove Gilbert."
"Did you look in on him after that?" Bruno asked.
"I did, sometime after 7, when most of the guests had gone, except for those staying the night," said Madeleine. "He was snoring, but there was no vomit. I'm sure if he'd been sick, I'd have smelled it. I didn't see that flask or I'd have removed it. I put that blanket over him.
Madeleine was pointing to a large leather-covered hip flask, perhaps twice the size of the one Bruno took when he went hunting. It lay between Gilbert's chest and his arm.
It was the same at about 10, when I looked in just before I went to bed, said Victor. No sign of vomit, and the blanket was still in place, as though he hadn't moved.
I heard he was an alcoholic. Is that true?
He was always a heavy drinker, Victor said. After he came back from Moscow, he was in bad shape. We got him into a couple of clinics and then into Alcoholics Anonymous, and he stopped drinking for a while. But he always went back to it, vodka mainly. He acquired a taste for the stuff in Russia, or maybe he assumed we wouldn't smell it on him.
Had he been this drunk before, throwing up in his sleep?
Not to my knowledge, but this was unusual, him being here at the chateau, Victor said.
He turned to look at the body of his friend, and the sadness on Victor's face aged him so that he looked more like Madeleine's father than her husband.
We didn't often have to put him to bed.
Just before I saw him being carried away from the party, he was obviously drunk but still on his feet, Bruno said.
Did he go straight to sleep when you brought him in here?
Yes, he seemed to crumple. By the time we got his shoes and tie off and laid him down, he'd passed out.
Bruno turned to Gilletro. Alcoholics usually have a fairly high tolerance for booze. Is this sort of reaction unusual in any way?
It might have been if we hadn't found the flask.
Bruno pulled on a pair of plastic gloves, then lifted the flask to his nose. It was empty, had no cap, and smelled of alcohol. He put it in an evidence bag and began looking around for the cap. He found it underneath the lounger. There were markings on the bottom of the flask, and he squinted in the dim light to make out, made in England, 12 ounces. He knew about English fluid ounces from whiskey bottles. 12 fluid ounces was a third of a litre. Bruno felt the dead man's clothes where the flask had been. There was no dampness. Whatever liquid it had contained had not spilled out. Presumably, he'd drunk all of it.
What did he usually drink?
Stolichnaya Blue, Victor replied. It's 100 proof, 50% pure alcohol.
Bruno raised his eyebrows. Gilbert had been stumbling drunk at 5 in the evening. Depending how much there had been in the flask, there was more than enough to keep him dead drunk until midnight.
Do you know if he left a will or where he kept his papers? I should go and take a look.
I don't know about a will, but he had nothing to leave. Gilbert was usually broke. He lived in a small house on the vineyard and had an old car, but with the drinking.
Victor ran his hand across his eyes.
You should have known him before. He was a good man, an amazing pilot, brave as a lion.
Gilbert hadn't driven a car for years, Madeleine interrupted. We wouldn't let him. He had a bicycle to get around the estate, and if he needed to go into Bergerac, he'd come with us.
There's nothing more for me to do here, and I'd better get to the clinic, said Dr. Gilletro,
handing Bruno the signed certificate of death. He'd written natural causes, alcohol abuse.
Has Gilbert's family been informed of his death? Bruno asked Victor as Gilletro left.
He had no family, only divorced wives and abandoned mistresses, said Madeleine sourly. Most of them will probably celebrate at the news.
Are there any next of kin that you know of? Bruno pressed. Brothers, sisters, cousins, there's usually some relative.
He always indicated me as next of kin, Victor responded. I was his wingman for years in the same squadron, so we were very close.
I think there was a sister who died a few years ago.
Bruno looked down at the body, thinking this was a sad end for a man gifted enough to be a fighter pilot, one of the lords of the air.
He remembered his own youthful dreams of becoming one.
In that case, you'll have to decide whether this is to be a burial or a cremation.
I can help you with that, broke in Father Santou, Perhaps I should call later in the day when you've had some time to settle yourselves.
Well, it all seems very straightforward, said the mayor briskly, in the way he did at council meetings when the main decision had been taken to his satisfaction. It's very sad, of course, and a great loss to you, Victor, saying farewell to an old friend and comrade of your youth. But I'm sure the chief of police here will handle matters with his usual discretion and dispatch.
He looked at Bruno and added, We don't want anything that could cast a shadow over the Patriarch's birthday.
Bruno nodded amiably while putting his hand beneath the body.
He found a full pocket and drew out a well-used wallet. There was an identity card, one of the old French driving licenses in pink cardboard, a carte bleue credit card, a carte vitale medical card, and 4 20-euro notes. In a smaller pocket, he found an out-of-date ID card for the Foreign Ministry and a membership card for the Air Force Association. He took the cheap mobile phone from the pouch on Gilbert's belt and thumbed through the recent calls, surprised at how few there were. He'd made just one call the previous day to a recipient identified as Victor.
He called you yesterday morning? Bruno asked Victor.
I took the call, said Madeleine. It was about what time we'd pick him up to drive here to the chateau.
Did you drive home after the party?
No, we stayed here last night, Victor replied.
His wife broke in. We live at the vineyard, but we keep a suite here.
Was Gilbert going to stay here as well?
Victor shrugged and looked at his wife. He seemed to let her answer most of the questions, Bruno thought.
No, the chateau is pretty full with guests, so Mark or somebody would have given him a lift back, she said. In fact, some of them must be getting up about now, so I'd better go and check on breakfast.
I'm sure the chief of police won't need to disturb your guests, the mayor said firmly and looked at his watch.
Just one more thing, said Bruno. I'd better take a look at Gilbert's house. Where is it exactly?
Madeleine explained, already at the door that led to the chateau.
Sorry, but I have to go. Excuse me, but I have to be at mass, said Father Santou, quickly shaking hands with Bruno and the mayor and following her out.
The mayor stepped forward, took Victor's hand and shook it solemnly in silence. Then he turned to put his hand on Bruno's back and steer him to the door. It was very neatly done.
You don't have any reason for doubt about this, do you? The mayor asked when they were outside.
No, not really, Bruno said. He was about to say that he didn't like being pressured, but his phone began vibrating at his belt. He checked the screen and saw it was Albert, the chief pompier.
There's been another accident on the Rufignac Road just after the turnoff to the big camping site, Albert said. It's those damned deer again. You'd better bring a gun in case the animal is still alive.
Chapter 4. The accident wasn't that serious, at least for the humans involved. A small van had hit a deer, which dented its hood and broke its headlights. Bruno knew the driver, Adele, a woman in her 40s whose husband worked for the milk cooperative. She'd been heading for church with her widowed mother. Adele was shocked and weeping. The mother was made of sterner stuff, leaning against the van and smoking an unfiltered cigarette as she looked critically at the deer. Both its front legs were broken, and it kept trying to rise on its back ones, bleating pitifully as it kept collapsing. It was painfully thin, its ribs sticking out through light brown fur, its chest heaving as it panted in terror.
There's not enough meat to make it worth taking back for the freezer, the old lady said. It will be that crazy woman up the hill again.
Bruno asked her to take her daughter back into the van while he took care of the deer. He pulled a tarpaulin from the back of his police van, asked Albert to hold it and screen the deer from Adele's sight. He dispatched the suffering beast with a shot behind the ear, and Albert helped him roll it onto the waxed canvas and put it into Bruno's van. Then Bruno drove the women to church in Adele's car, reckoning she'd be in good enough shape to drive after the service.
Albert drove him back to his van, and he took the dead deer to the local butcher.
"Hardly worth it," said Valentin, when Bruno had laid out the deer on the chopping block in the room just behind the shop. Deer killed on the roads of Saint-Denis were given to the butcher, who'd prepare the meat for the old folks' home.
"There's no flesh on it. It must be one of Imogen's. I keep telling you, Bruno, you're going to have to do something about that stupid woman."
"We're doing our best, but the law isn't exactly fast on these matters," Bruno replied. "She still has a few weeks to put up that fence the court ordered, and then she might try an appeal."
"One of these days, those deer will kill someone, mark my words," said Valentin, picking up a cleaver.
Valentin was right, Bruno reflected, as he drove up the hill to the home of Imogène Ducaillou. A pleasant but eccentric widow, she worked as a cashier and caretaker in one of the smaller prehistoric caves that dotted the region. She was a mainstay of the town's literary club, with an inexhaustible appetite for romantic novels and books about animals. She owned and lived on a large tract of mostly forested land that abutted one of the main roads leading to Saint-Denis. A passionate green and strict vegetarian, she loved all animals and hated hunting. She'd posted chasse interdite notices all around her land, which was surrounded by hunting preserves that were used by the town's hunting clubs. Deer aren't foolish. Given a choice between land stalked by hunters and territory where they were banned, as soon as the hunting season opened, the deer made a refuge of Imogen's property, just as she had wished. At first, all was well, although the hunters were unhappy at the scarcity of game in their traditional preserves. But soon the concentration of deer on Imogen's land had become a different kind of problem, as their population exploded and destroyed much of her vegetation. As a result, the deer were all painfully thin and becoming desperate enough to risk the hunters' guns in their search for food. Today's accident was the third in the past year to have been caused by deer leaving her land, despite warning signs and speed limits placed by Bruno on that stretch of road. Imogen had repeatedly rejected pleas by Bruno and the mayor to allow the deer on her land to be culled. As a last resort, the prefect had secured a court order instructing that Imogen must fence her land within 6 months to protect those driving on the road nearby. 5 months had passed, and she still hadn't done so. It would be expensive, probably too much for her to afford. Deer were everywhere as Bruno drove up the winding gravel lane that led to Imogen's house, stretching up to nibble the remaining bark on trees, nosing into the earth to see if any shoots remained. There was no undergrowth, just earth and dead trees, and Bruno could see the wooden watchtowers standing ominously at the edges of Imogen's property where the hunters waited for the deer to risk leaving her land in the search for food. The sight gave him an eerie feeling, evoking memories of newsreels of prison camps guarded by similar towers manned by sharpshooters. Bruno stopped and climbed out of his vehicle, struck by the sense of standing at a frontier. Over a belt of some 30 or 40 metres, the woodland thickened from barren earth and bare trees on Imogen's property to the usual fertile jumble of shrubs and ferns. Gazing at this strange contrast, his eyes sensed a sudden movement, and he realized that one of the watchtowers was manned. He leaned through his car window and sounded the horn until he saw an answering wave from the distant blind. He walked toward it, moving through the steadily thickening vegetation and into a clearing. The hide stood on its far side, mounted on four sturdy poles. Two men in camouflage jackets, one big and burly and the other shorter and slim, looked down at Bruno curiously.
"Come to check our hunting permits?" asked the bigger man.
He looked familiar, as though Bruno had seen him in another context. His flat tweed cap triggered Bruno's memory. This was the gamekeeper at the Patriarch's chateau, the man who had carried Gilbert from the party. The smaller man was hanging back a little, almost as though trying to keep out of Bruno's view.
"I can if you want," Bruno replied affably. "But I was going to ask if you knew whether Imogen is at home, or if you'd seen her car leave."
"That crazy bitch," the big man said.
"No,
We've seen no cars coming and going until you arrived, and we've seen no deer close enough for a shot, not even those skinny ones that come from her land. They probably know you're here, said Bruno.
The shorter man lifted a hand to pull his baseball cap farther down over his eyes, and Bruno recognized him as Guillaume, a bartender at one of the big campsites in summer who signed on as unemployed for the rest of the year. The gendarme had picked him up a couple of times on suspicion of dealing drugs to campers, but nothing had ever been proved. Guillaume was a notoriously poor shot, but still had the right to hunt his quota. Such men were useful. A keen hunter could go out with Guillaume, shoot in his stead, and share the meat. And there were some who just liked extra opportunities to shoot to kill.
Bonjour, Guillaume, Bruno said. Who's your friend?
I'm Fabrice, said the gamekeeper. I'm just spotting for Guillaume.
Don't you work for the Patriarch? Wasn't it you I saw at his party carrying away that drunk?
That's right. He was plastered, didn't give me any trouble. Laid him down and he went right to sleep.
Do you know he's dead? Bruno asked. Died in his sleep.
I've just come from the chateau.
Fabrice shook his head, looking surprised.
Poor bastard.
Then he shrugged and said,
there are worse ways to go.
Bruno considered checking their permits, but he needed to see Imogen and so just wished them luck, told them to watch out for his return, and headed back. He drove on at a crawl, but had to keep stopping as the deer strolled along the road and gazed at him incuriously, somehow knowing that they faced no danger on these lands. He found it rather beguiling, thinking that a real refuge such as this could be a wonderful place, so long as there was sufficient food and water, and a rational culling or export plan to prevent overpopulation. Perhaps that could be a solution, and maybe funds could be raised to help Imogen pay for the fence and the food. But she was unlikely to accept the culling. Bruno knew he'd have to try, pointing out the desperate thinness of the deer and the weakness of the young fawns he saw. As he parked the van and climbed out, looking at Imogen's rundown house with its missing tiles and sagging shutters, deer came up to nuzzle Bruno, doubtless hoping for food. She must feed them herself with what little money she has, he thought. He knocked on the door, which was suffering from years without repainting, and got no reply. But her old Renault 4 was parked beside the house and her bicycle was on the porch. He knocked again and called her name, saying it was Bruno.
What do you want? She said from behind the closed door.
There's been another accident on the road. One of your deer had its legs broken.
So what did you do? Kill it? That's all you know what to do. Kill, hunt, kill. Why can't you leave the animals in peace?
Because they're starving, Imogen. The fawns are dying. The deer are desperate, so they come onto the roads.
This can't go on, Imogen. Open the door and let's talk about this. I have an idea that might help.
The door opened and Imogen eyed him suspiciously.
What sort of idea?
She looked normal enough, short grey hair neatly brushed, brown corduroy slacks and a bulky sweater. She wore neither makeup nor jewellery. The sound of a piano concerto came from the room within.
You only have a few weeks to put up a fence, and you can't afford it.
That means you either pay a stiff fine, which might mean having to sell your property, or you let us organize a cull of the deer. You're now a bigger danger to these starving deer than the hunters.
You've said that before. I'm trying to raise funds from other animal lovers. I'll find a way, but what's this idea of yours?
I was thinking, as I drove up here, how pleasant it could be to have a real refuge, properly fenced and with sufficient food, to allow school children to come and walk here among the deer, absent of cars. Maybe some tourists in the season could pay enough of an entrance fee to help feed the animals. It would mean fencing the whole property, but I think there may be ways to raise funds for that.
There has to be a catch, Imogen said. But you're the first man who's come here talking any sense at all. Of course, it would be a wonderful place for children. Come in and have some tea and we can talk about it.
He entered a large sitting room that took up half the house. A kitchen was on the far side, where Imogen put a kettle on the old-fashioned wood stove that served both for heating and for cooking. The radio was set to France Musique, the piano music giving way to a voice he recognized. Three cats occupied an old sofa that looked comfortable. There was a big round table covered in sketch pads, magazines, and photographs of deer. More photos of deer filled the spaces on the walls that were not occupied by bookcases. Some of the deer were so thin he assumed Imogen must have taken them in these woods.
"I know everybody in town thinks I'm mad, but I'm perfectly rational," Imogen said, giving him a cracked mug of what smelled like mint tea. "I know the deer are hungry, and my land can't support them."
Imogen went on to explain that she'd been promised some funds from animal rights groups, but not nearly enough. She'd been quoted 14,000 euros to have the fence built, and that wouldn't be for the whole property, just the stretch by the road and a couple of hundred meters farther back on each side.
"I've already got a mortgage on this property that I can barely afford, although heaven knows I've got nobody to leave it to," she said. "I can't afford a fence and can't afford to buy any more fodder for the deer. I'm at my wit's end, and I'm ready to consider anything that won't involve hunting them or killing them. That I just can't allow."
Bruno wondered if any compromise would be possible. When she spoke of her deer, Imogen had an almost religious fervour. It would be hard to shake her conviction, but he had to try. "We'd need to assess just how many deer this land of yours could maintain. Looking at it now, it wouldn't be many. Your woods are dying from the deer chewing the bark and the shoots."
"And what happens to the deer you'd call excess?" she asked.
"We could try zoos, other refuges, perhaps release them elsewhere in national parks." It sounded feeble, even to Bruno.
"You think I haven't tried that? All the animal refuges in France have the same problem. Some of them are even using contraception to stop the animals from breeding. And most of the national parks permit hunting these days, to their shame. No, Bruno, thanks for trying. I appreciate that you want to help, but we both know that your solution would mean culling the herd every year, and I couldn't permit that."
"The choice seems very clear, Imogen. Either you have the refuge and give a lot of your deer a good life, or you lose all of them, whether to the courts or to starvation. You could easily lose your house and land as well. If one of your deer causes an accident that kills or injures people, you'll be sued for every penny you've got."
"I understand what you're saying."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.